and direct you through that. Yes, sir. You know what? We can do that now because we don't have to have people come in and clean. Yeah, we'll start at the back and work to the front. That way people don't have to walk past, okay? That's a good suggestion, see? Now, we also have the armbands in the back. The green one means that you're okay with someone shaking your hand, okay? So if you want to get them, they're in the back there. See Annie. And if you have a yellow one on, come here. If you can get a yellow one, if you don't want, if your immune system might not be quite, or you just don't feel comfortable and you want to fist bump, and that's it, and stay away, that means kind of cautious. And if you got a red one, like Ben, that means just say hi, I love you, Ben, from here, okay? All right, everybody excited? Yeah, man, let's have church, how about it? We got baptisms going on today, praise God, woo!
Well, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. Well, call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, just tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. If you want salvation, tell him what you want. If you want salvation, tell him what you want. If you want salvation, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. If you want the Holy Ghost, tell him what you want. If you want the Holy Ghost, tell him what you want. If you want the Holy Ghost, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. Now if you want a healing, tell him what you want. If you want a healing, tell him what you want. If you want a healing, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. Now if you want the victory, tell him what you want. If you want the victory, tell him what you want. If you want the victory, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. Yeah, Jesus on the main line now.
Some of you may have noticed that I'm without the band this morning. The praise and worship team is just me this morning. Brunlaw is on vacation, and Cassidy is home with Elena. She's sick. So, we will be alone today.
But there are some things that I may not know. There are some places I just can't go. Oh, but I am sure of this one thing. My God is real, for I can feel him deep within. Well, my God is real.
My God is real.
He's real in my soul.
He's real in my soul.
My God is real, for his watch made me whole. For his love for me,
his love for me,
is like pure gold. My God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. Well, I cannot tell just how I felt when Jesus washed my sins away. But since that day, oh, since that hour, God has been real, for I can feel his holy power. Well, my God is real. He's real in my soul. My God is real, for he's watched, made me whole. Well, his love for me,
his
is like pure gold. My God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. I'm thirsty, Lord. I'm thirsty, Lord. I'm thirsty, Lord, for the living waters of life. I want to drink. I want. I want to drink from the living waters of life. Fill me up, Lord, I don't have to feel it, but make me drunk with your Holy Spirit, then I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink from the living waters of life. But I'm tired of whispering, I'll start to shout. Don't want a cup, Lord, give me a fountain. Then I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink from the living waters of life. I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink from the living waters of life. I'll take another drink. I'll take another drink. I'll take another drink from the living waters of life. Amen. So glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to sing your praise.
Lord, I love to sing your praise.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the cross to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Father God, that's what we need this morning, Father. Father, we need the rain of the Holy Spirit to fall in this place, God. Father, we ask God right now that everything that has been weighing heavy on us throughout the week, God, that Father God, that we can leave it at the door this morning. And that God, that we can come in here in one mind, in one purpose to do one thing, God. And that is to worship and to praise you this morning. God, your people needs to hear from you this morning. God, your people needs to be filled by you this morning. God, your people needs to be guided by you this morning. God, we need that power of the Holy Spirit to fill us in our lives, God, in our minds and our bodies. God, we are surrounded by just things that are trying to come against us, God. But your word says that when you've done all to stand, stand. God, we're standing this morning and we're standing in your presence, God. And God, we ask God for a new and fresh filling, God. God, we're asking, God, let it rain in this place. Let the Holy Spirit rain in this place. Let your body, just your presence rain in this place, God. Oh, God, fill us, God. For God, there is so much out there that consumes our thoughts, consumes our hearts. God just draws us. God just drains us, God. But God, right now we have come for that one purpose, for that you could fill us, God. God, I ask this morning, God, as we come to you this morning, first thing I want to do is I want to thank you, Father. God, Sister Rosemary walked in here this morning. We thank you for bringing her back from a heart operation, God. We thank you for that. We missed our sister. We've been praying for her. God, you have answered prayer, and we thank you for that, God. God, we want to lift up Nancy Norman right now with lung cancer. God, she's doing radiation. God, radiation draws it. It sucks the life out of you. God, right now we pray for that life to be put back in her, God. God, we want that cancer healed in Jesus' precious name. Father, we lift up Sister Rice. She just celebrated another birthday, Father. We thank you for that. God, we pray for strength. We pray for a healing on her, God. Move on Sister Rice's life, God. Father, we lift up Skipper to you right now. He is in ICU with pneumonia, God. They are testing for corona. But God, right now, he is in ICU with pneumonia. And God, we pray, we plead the blood of Jesus over for that pneumonia to be healed. Father, we lift up Brother Dalton. He's gone this Thursday for cataract surgery. God, guide the surgeon's hands. God, let him come out of there with the least a bit of light sensitivity, no pain. God, we want total vision back, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for Curtis Viator. God, we ask God this morning, God, he needs kidneys, God. God, we pray that, God, that either you would heal those kidneys or, God, open up a way for a transplant, God. We're not limiting, God. We just want you to handle it. He needs kidneys, God, in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father, we thank you and we praise you, Father. We lift up John Luke Lawson to you, God, in Jesus' name. Father, we ask God right now that the Holy Spirit would just fall in that room right now. Father, the chemo is messing with him, but in Jesus' name, that name of Jesus is more than chemo. Father, that virus, God, in Jesus' name, has got to leave. God, we ask for a total healing for this little three-year-old. God, we pray that you would raise him up, get him home, God. God, let him raise up. Let him grow up praising you, thanking you, God, for what you have done, God. Father, we lift up Tony. She is having open heart surgery, God, this month. God, in Jesus' name, we pray that you'd guide the surgeon's hands. After it, God, you're going to have to do some healing, Father. They can cut, they can sew, but God, you've got to do the healing. Father, we lift up Bonnie Longlinet to you right now, praying for healing for cervical and brain cancer, God. Once more, God, you created the body. Healing it is nothing, Father. Father, you spoke everything into existence. All you have to do is say the word, God, in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father, we lift up Betty. She had a stroke, praying for healing. God, what the stroke has tried to take away, in Jesus' name, we pray not only would it be given back, but it'd be more stronger than it was before, Father. Father, we lift up John Paul Armstrong, a 12-year-old, God, third time needing a heart transplant. Right now, we plead the blood of Jesus over that situation. God, he needs a heart transplant, but this time, God, let it be the last one. God, raise up that child. Healer. God, in Jesus' name, let him be a living testimony to you, Father, in Jesus' name. Father God, we lift up prayer for the pilot, Scotty. He was in a plane crash, God. Right now, in Jesus' name, God, we need looking for 100% healing, God, in his body, Father. Father, Kelly Rachel with lupus is attacking the inner organs right now, Father. God, in Jesus' name, we speak healing, God, to that body. We thank you and we praise you, Father, because we know the Creator. We know that you are not limited in anything, God. Heal this, God. Let it be a testimony in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father, we lift up Nan Faulkner to you right now. Surgery for her heart on the 15th. God, a lot of heart situations, God. Father God, right now, in Jesus' name, God, I pray that, God, that you would guide and lead on that surgery, and God, that you would heal. Get Nan back up, Father, in Jesus' name. Bob Thibodeau had a stroke and some other heart problems, Father God, right now. Brother Dalton said this morning that he is doing better. We thank you for that. We need 100%, Father. We need 100% in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father God, we lift up Brother Will and Sister Liz. They're healing from the coronavirus, God, right now. Brother Will's cutting up like he's normally doing. He's feeling better. Father, he's getting close to them coming back with us, God. We just pray, God, right now. We thank you for protecting them and healing them. Move in Jesus' precious name. Father, we lift up Linda and Pete and Mandy Combe, diagnosed with COVID. God, in Jesus' name, we pray for a total healing in their body. God, move. Move in Jesus' name. Michael Shockley Jr. in an accident, in a coma. Father God, right now, God, we pray that you would heal him. Bring him out of that coma, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Father, we lift up Sister Ruth with you with back and foot pain right now, God. You know what the situation is, God. I pray that, God, in Jesus' name, that, God, that you would move on Sister Ruth and that, God, that you would heal. Father, Peggy with COVID, God, in Jesus' name, we ask, God, that you would move on Peggy and that you would heal her. Father, Sister Bridget's brother just diagnosed with the COVID, God, we pray for protection, that, God, that you would bring him through it real quickly, a healing in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father, a praise report for Preston, 7 years old, that was in that same crash from that pilot we just prayed from. God, he is home now recovering. We give you thanks and praise for that. God, again, 100%. Father, we've been praying for our Ferris Smith. Ferris Smith is healed, and we thank you in Jesus' precious and holy name. Father, we just prayed for Manny Combe. The word is home from the hospital with COVID, and she needs a continuing healing, Father. She had a rough time in the hospital. We thank you for healing her to where she could go back home for the final situation of raising her up and getting her back serving you, God, in Jesus' name. Father, we want to give you thanks for Cindy Rossinette with her nerve pain in her lower back, feeling some better. God, we pray for a total healing, God, in that nerve, God, right now in Jesus' name. Father God, we want to thank you this morning for the baptisms, God. Father, we want to thank you for your presence and your love. God, we want to thank you for your power just falling in this place. God, we want to thank you this morning for changing lives. God, we ask, God, that you would continue to move today. Move, touch in Jesus' name. And we just ask it. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Let it rain. Let it pour from heaven. Let it rain to revive my soul. I need your rain. I need your streams of refreshing. Your streams of refreshing. Until I thirst no more.
Praise God. Praise God. Everybody who's happy to be here this morning, go, yee-haw. I appreciate y'all doing that. That makes me feel good. God's good, isn't he? Man, he is moving. He is moving in New Iberia. He is moving. You know, I got tickled. Brother Will sent me a picture of him. He sent me a picture of him, and he's got his shirt on. He's smiling. He's going like this right here. He said, feeling good. I can only imagine what he'll be like when I walk by your side. Well, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. Well, I can only imagine
I can only imagine.
Y'all sing with me, come on.
Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to a knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Oh yeah. Well, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. Well, I can only imagine when all we will do is forever, ever worship you. Well, I can only imagine. Gonna be great, isn't it?
Woo!
Well, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to a knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Oh yeah. Well, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to a knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Oh yeah. Well, I can only imagine.
Can you wrap your mind around it?
I can only imagine. Oh yeah. Well, I can only imagine.
Praise God.
Well, I can only imagine. Oh yeah. Well, I can only imagine.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. God is so good, is he not? Man. Whew. Water. Water. Water's good, isn't it? I love water. That's what we're going to talk about, waters today. Yes, waters. How many people got your Bible today? Got my Bible, yeah. I love to hear that. You know, water is good, isn't it? Water is life. You know, it's said that the body can go without food for almost a month. Unbelievable, huh? But it can only go without water for about 4 days. That's it. About 4 days is all it can go without water. See, water is very important to us. See, water's in the Bible a lot. It talks about water in the Bible a whole lot. Matter of fact, it mentions in the Bible about water 722 times. 722 times. Now, that's a lot of water, right? See, water is very important to us. Water is so significant to us. Water, it talks about water is what is life. It talks about water is the Word. It talks about water is Jesus, doesn't it? Water is very important. Man, I get to reading in my Bible and thinking about different stuff. And we're going to go right now to Revelations 21:6. When you get there, say amen. Revelations 21:6. And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give the fountain of the water of life freely to him who thirsts." Man, that's a good word, isn't it? That is good word. That is good word right there. You know, he is our Father. He is our God. He loves us. He's always there for us, isn't he? He's always there for us. And man, we are wretched people, are we not? Ungrateful by nature. Always bellyaching. You know, we inherited something one time from Adam. From the very start, we inherited this. Right? I love that passage where it says that God says, "Where art thou?" And he goes, "I'm over here, Lord, I'm hiding." He goes, "Why are you hiding?" He goes, "Well, I ate from that apple." "Why'd you do that?" "It was that woman you gave me." I mean, immediately. Have you ever seen kids do that? Who did that? Right? They're always pointing. One of my favorite YouTube videos is there's these four dogs, and they're sitting over there, and there's a torn up pillow there, and all of them's got their heads down. Mama's yelling at them. And she said, "Now, which one of y'all did it?" And the three other dogs look over at this one. I love that. We're good to go. It's their fault. I mean, aren't we? We're good to do that. And we're good to bellyache, too. See, how many people was here Wednesday or paid attention to Wednesday's service? Put your hands up. Did you do that? Fantastic. Well, I lied to y'all Wednesday. I lied to y'all, so we got to make it right. I lied to y'all whenever I was talking about Samson. See, I got tied up, and that's why you should never believe everything that the preacher always tells you. You need to go back and look at that. It's important to do that because, hey, I'm just a man like everybody else. Well, some of y'all are women in here, too. And a whole lot prettier than us men, that's for sure. God knew what he was doing, didn't he? But we're going to turn right now to Samson, talking about Samson. Judges 15:8. When you get there, say amen. You know, I thought it was important to go back to that and tell y'all about it because I did. I got excited and I exaggerated whenever it talked about Samson. Wednesday. See, I said that Samson killed 10,000 men with a jawbone, but he didn't. He killed 1,000, didn't he? He killed 1,000. We're going to talk about that because I love this. I love how God is so great and God takes care of us. Matter of fact, let's go to Judges 15:15. We're going to start in 15:15 because I want to lead into this. It says in 15:15, when you get there, say amen. He found a fresh jawbone of a donkey. He reached out with his hand and took it up and killed 1,000 men with it. 1,000 men. Something about 7.5 inches long, somewhere right around in there. Killed 1,000 men with it. And then he said, with this jawbone of a donkey, heaps upon heaps, with the jawbone of a donkey, I have slain 1,000 men. And so it was said that when he had finished speaking, that he threw the jawbone from his hand and called that place Ramaleah. Then he became very thirsty. So he cried out to the Lord and said, "You have given me this great deliverance by the hand of your servant, and now shall I die of thirst and fall into the hand of the uncircumcised?" Could you imagine that? Could you imagine, first of all, you pick up a jawbone of this animal and you kill 1,000 men who are trying to come at you, and then you step back and you complain to God because I killed all them people, now you're going to let me die of thirst? Isn't that just like us? Isn't that just like us? Don't we get in that situation where we do that all the time? It cracks me up whenever I read about the Israelites and about people in the Bible and how they bellyache, and I look now, and man, we are the same people. We're the same people. We bellyache all the time about everything, don't we? These third world problems that we have. My seat in my truck was hot. Boy, you ought to walk 300 miles in the desert. Amen. Let's turn, if we would, to Numbers 20. Numbers 20. When you get there, say amen. Numbers 20. When you get there, say amen. Then the children of Israel, the whole congregation, came into the wilderness of Zin. And in the first month, and the people stayed in Kadesh, and Miriam died there and was buried there. Now there was no water for the congregation. So they gathered together against Moses and Aaron. And the people contended with Moses and spoke, saying, "If only we had died when our brethren died before the Lord. Why have you brought us up to assemble of the Lord into this wilderness, that we and our animals should die here? And why have you made us come out of Egypt to bring us to this evil place? Is it not a place? It's not a place of grain or figs or vines or pomegranates, nor is there any water to drink." Well, that doesn't sound like us, does it? We're always, they were bellyaching. So it says, so Moses went from their presence and he called to the Lord. We know the rest of that story, right? See, they were after water. They were thirsting for water, weren't they? Let's go to Exodus 17. This is one of my favorite stories. Exodus 17. When you get there, say amen. Exodus 17. It says, then all the congregation, boy, this sounds like a rerun almost, don't it? Then all the congregation of the children of Israel set out on their journey from the wilderness of Sin, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped in Rephidim, I think is how you pronounce that. But there is no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people contended with Moses and said, "Give us water that we may drink." So Moses said to them, "Why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord?" And the people thirst for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why is it that you have brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord says to Moses, "Go on before the people, take some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand your rod, which you struck the river, and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock of Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and the water will come out of it, and the people may drink." And Moses did this, the sight of the elders, so he called the name of the place Massah, or Meribah, because of the contention of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Do you ask yourself that sometimes? Do you ask yourself that? Do you say, "Man, is the Lord really with us or not?" Man, I promise you, he's with you. He is always with you because the Bible says he is. The Bible says that he's with you, that he's there beside you, that he will never leave you. See, that in turn spurred on the whole Feast of the Tabernacles. That instance right there where he struck the water and the water come out of the rock. Think about that for a second, how much water that was. We're talking a million people. A million people. And their livestock. And their animals. Now, everybody can drink a gallon of water, especially if you're walking across the desert. Could you imagine how much water come up out of that rock? enough for over a million gallons come up out of that rock. I'm not talking about a little stream, and it didn't take them 30 days to drink there. I mean, it come out with a big gush. See, that's my God. My God's big enough to handle all situations. My God's the God so big that he brought manna down from heaven, enough to feed a million people. Can you imagine how much that was? Could you imagine a million biscuits falling from the sky on a daily basis? Now, what about the quail? Think about that. How many quail? How many quail can you eat? I know I can eat two or three. Could you imagine 3 million quail? 3 million quail coming out. Man, if that don't get you excited, that's our God. Not just one time, but throughout the whole time that they were out there. He kept bringing it time after time after time after time. And he told them, don't save it up. Don't store it up because it ain't going to last. Man, that's my God. He's the God that always provides. He provides for on a regular basis. Amen? He gives them the water. He gave them the water. He gave them the word that is the water. He gives us the water. Turn to Deuteronomy 8:15. Deuteronomy 8:15. See, these are important scriptures. Deuteronomy 8:15. They're all important, but this is important for today. It's talking about in the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. When you get there, say amen. Deuteronomy 8:15. He who led through the great and terrible wilderness in which were fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty land where there was no water, who brought water from out of the flinty rock. See, that's the man right there. That's the God right there. Turn to Nehemiah 9. Nehemiah 9. Nehemiah 9:15. When you get there, say amen. It said, you gave them bread from heaven for their hunger and brought them water out of the rock for their thirst. Gave them bread from heaven and brought them water out of the rock for their thirst. Turn to Psalms 114. Could you imagine we're in Psalms? Psalms 114, 7 through 8. When you get there, say amen. Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of God of Jacob, who turned the rock into a pool of water, the flint into fountains of water. See, Psalms, this was a song that they sang, right? Psalms that was wrote that they used. Turn to Isaiah 12, 3 and 4. Isaiah 12, 3 and 4. When you get there, say amen. Isaiah 12, 3 and 4. When you get there, say amen. Therefore, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. Whoa, hang on a second. We're not talking about just regular water here, are we? The wells of salvation. And in that day, you will say, praise the Lord, call upon his name. I wonder whose name. Declare his name among the people. Declare his name. Man, I think that's talking about my Jesus. Make mention that his name is exalted. Mention that his name is exalted. That's going to take us to where we're going to start talking about this. In John 4:13, when you get there, say amen. I'm going to set this up for you a little bit. Y'all have all read this story. I know you've read this story a million times about the Samaritan woman at the well. You've heard this story, right? Let me tell you something a little bit that y'all may not know. See, there was a bitter hatred between Jews and the Samaritans. Long standing. Okay? This went on from years. From about 722 BC. See, the Assyrians conquered the northern kingdom and swept Israel away with captivity. And during those years, the Jews dropped the prohibitions against and started intermarrying with the Assyrians. They lost their ethnic purity. Comes with part of that the reason why God wanted them to go in there and destroy them all in the first place. See, then around 586 BC, the Babylonians conquered the southern kingdom of Judea. During the captivity, they started intermarrying with the Babylonians because of being captured and taking the spoils of war and taking the ladies on as their wives, started having children. And these are the Samaritans. This is the Samaritans. There was such a hatred between the Jews and Samaritans. Now, this is sad to say. Man, I have been known to dislike some people in my day, but I have never disliked anybody to the point that I wish that they wouldn't ever be able to get into heaven. But let me tell you what the Jews used to pray. They would say, "Lord, do not remember the Samaritans in the resurrection." That's how much they hated them. Could you imagine that? You hate someone so much that you ask the Lord, when you pray before the Lord, you ask the Lord to not remember those people on the day of resurrection. Now that's a hate, isn't it? Now can you see why the Samaritan woman, her eyes got real big and she kind of freaked out whenever Jesus was sitting at the well, a Jew, and asked her for a drink? She said, "What are you doing asking me for a drink?" She probably thought if I gave you a drink, you wouldn't drink of it. Because, see, Samaritans and Jews didn't talk. They didn't even hang around. Samaritans weren't even allowed in the temple area. See, they had to go up on the mountain to worship. And they really didn't know what they were worshiping even. See, they had done kind of like what happened. I went to Haiti one time, did some stuff there in Haiti, and it was pretty crazy that I met this voodoo. Voodoo's very thick over there. I met this voodoo guy, and we had taught him the word of God, and he was starting to teach the word of God, and we come back a month later, and he was doing voodoo rituals with the word of God and some other stuff. He had kind of intertwined all of it together to kind of make everybody feel happy, I guess, or he thought, well, I just, instead of doing away with this, I'll just add to it. See, that's kind of what the Samaritans had done. They'd taken a little bit of this culture and a little bit of the Babylonians, a little bit of this, and they'd taken it and moved it to their own type of religion, see. So you could imagine the astonishment on the Samaritan woman's face whenever someone with such pure hatred towards her asked her for a drink of water. Matter of fact, if we start in 4:9 there, it says, "Then the woman of Samaria said to him, 'How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman?' For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." And Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." And the woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get the living water? Are you greater than the father of Jacob, who gives us this well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock? And Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst again. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up in everlasting life. Man, doesn't that sound like Isaiah 12:3? The fountain of water, the living water of life, praise God. And the woman said to him, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come to draw water again. See, she still didn't get it. She thought it was just going to get her out of some work, right? Isn't that what some of us do whenever we go on and we start coming to church and we get cleaned up and we start trying to live our life right and we take on Jesus because we're thinking it might get us out of some work? Little do we know that that's when the work begins. But it begins inside of you, right? It begins inside of you. It's a work that draws no sweat or labor. It's a work that starts working inside of you, cleaning you up, getting you prepared for a better and greater thing that God's got for you. Amen? I love that scripture. I love that scripture when he talks about that. Now we're going to talk about another time whenever Jesus talks to them about the living water. Turn, if you would, to John 7. John 7. 37. I want y'all to picture this for a second. Remember we talking about whenever Moses struck the rock? Moses struck the rock. I'll get it out here in a second. Moses struck the rock and water come up out of it. And they made a feast of the tabernacles. Out of that, one of their big ceremonies that they did that lasted a week. See, I'm setting y'all up for this story to let y'all understand a little bit more about it. Maybe some of you do, maybe some of you don't. But see, what they did during this Feast of Tabernacles is the priest would take these gold pitchers and they would go down to the well of Siloam and they would dip that water in the golden pitchers and they would bring it back to the altar where they did the sacrifices on the stones. And every evening they'd pour the water and let it run down off the stones onto the ground to represent the water that Moses, whenever he struck the rock and the water come up out of the rock. See, it was the significance of the living water. See, they didn't understand that the significance of the living water coming out of that rock, the living water, all they saw was that was the living water that saved their lives. Because, see, they had been walking for 3 or 4 days, right, without water. And they were to the point of wanting to perish, and they realized the living water was the water that come up out of that rock. Could you imagine? Whenever Jesus, the astonishment of these priests and these Pharisees, whenever we pick up here at John 7:37, and it says, on the last day of the great day of the feast, talking about the last day of this day of the Feast of Tabernacles, where they would take and they would pour the water on the last day. Part of their ritual was pouring this water on and running down. It was part of their spiritual significance. And Jesus cried out to them saying, if anyone thirst, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, he's talking about that right there, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Man, I bet you they were wanting to stone him so bad right then whenever he said that. Because, man, what did he do? He just told them right there, Don't worry about the water coming out of the rock down there at Moses. I'm the water that the scriptures talked about. And some of them said, who is this guy who says he's the living water? We all know that it was Moses' water that came out of the rock. And some of them said, this is the Messiah. See, some of them got it, didn't they? Some of them understood what he was talking about. Others were as lost as a goose. Others wanted to kill him because they thought that he was blaspheming, because he said that that's not the water, I'm the water. Man, he was the water, wasn't he? He is still the water. See, here's the significance of it. Here's what they really missed. Not only is he the water, not only is he just the water, but he's the rock. He's the cornerstone. He's the cornerstone rock, and the living water comes up out of him. Praise God. He's it. What did we read in Revelations? He's the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. He's everything. He is all that in a bag of chips. He is it. He is what we're going for. He's what we've been looking for. Man, little did they know, he wasn't just the Messiah. He was the Savior. He was the Alpha, the Omega. He was everything wrapped up into one. And he was saying, here I am. Come be a part of me. Woo! Man, I talked about the water Wednesday, about my dogs drinking the water and how spoilt that they are, that they used to drink out of ponds and tanks and stuff around the farm, and then we brought them, and now they're, Angela's been going out there, and she puts water out of the faucet and sets it down. Now our dog Duke, he won't eat until she gets fresh water out of the fountain for him. He just sits there and looks at his water bowl and looks at her and looks back at the water bowl and looks at her. Like, are you going to freshen this up and cool this off or what? He is so spoilt to the good water. I mean, he went from this murky tank water to this water. And he don't want to go back. He don't want to go back. He wants that fresh, clean water. Matter of fact, he don't want any pine needles in it or nothing. He just wants fresh, clean water. That's what he wants. Man, I can understand. I want fresh, clean water. Man, I'll tell you what I'm looking for. I'm looking for smart water. Okay, everybody needs smart water, but the water that I'm looking for more than smart water is the living water. I want that living water to wash me clean. And it says it will in the Word. It says that the Word will wash us clean. It's the Word. It's everything. Do you understand the significance of the water and the rock? Man, the clean water. But you know, sometimes whenever we give our life to Christ, whenever we become the fountain of the water inside of us, sometimes we allow things to happen, right? Sometimes we allow things to happen. Let me tell y'all a little story about this buddy of mine who's a poet. And he was writing this story about had a cow that come up missing. So he went out searching for the cow. He started riding up this stream because he was following the footprints. He was riding up the stream. He was riding along, and all of a sudden, he caught a little smell. He thought, ooh, what is that smell? He rode up around the bend. Whenever he got around the bend, he noticed that it was that cow. That cow had laid down in the creek there and died. And there ain't no telling how long he'd quite been there. It swelled up, and kind of tight, and oozing its, putting oily gunk in the stream. Ugh. And he said that he pulled up and he got off his horse and went over and sat down because he wasn't really feeling right because of the sight. And then he thought of something that made him feel worse. He remembered 30 yards back he had got down off his horse and drank till his belly almost burst. Now see, there's a story to that. See, if you're off and you're riding a horse and you've got to take a drink from a stream, never get on your horse and remount and ride upstream, right? But, you know, isn't that us sometimes? Isn't that us? Don't we take, we've got that old dead cow of sin. We got that old dead cow. We got all that sin that's putrid our water. It's taking and it's making our water dirty and putrid, and it stinks and it's bitter. And see, we spew that water out sometimes, and we spew it out, and people who are sitting from a distance who haven't gave their life to Christ are looking at us, and they're watching us, and they say, man, the water looks clean, but it smells bad. We all get like that. Life does that to us. Hurt, pain, sin. Man, it just bitters up that water sometimes, don't it? We want to be that fountain of clean water. We want to be that water that runs, that brings people to it to drink by the way we live our life. But life gets in the way of that, don't it? It gets in the way. It causes us to look back at it and man, it just makes you bitter sometimes. Sometimes it makes you bitter. But you know what? Here's how good my God is. Here's how good my God is. Turn to Exodus 15, 22. When you get there, say amen. Exodus 15, 22. See, Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Then they went out into the wilderness of Shur. And when they went out 3 days, now, remember us talking about a person, you know, the last 4 days without water? When they went 3 days into the wilderness and found no water. Now, they come to Moriah. And they come there and it had water. But they could not drink the waters of Moriah, for they were bitter. Could you imagine you hadn't had water in 3 days? Could you imagine not having a drink in 3 days? And you come across this water and you look, and that water is so bitter that you can't drink it. Now, that would be some bitter water. If you've went 3 days without water and you can't drink that water because it's bitter, that's some pretty bitter water, isn't it? I love this. Therefore, the name of it was Moriah. And the people complained against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? So he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. And he cut off that tree and threw it into the water. And the waters were made sweet. See, let me tell you something. If you've got stuff bitter inside of you, if you've got things that's turned your water bitter and you're not sweet anymore, man, let me tell you something. There's a tree of life. It's called Jesus Christ. Reach up, take off a branch, and throw it in your fountain of your water, and your water will become sweet again. See, that's what we're supposed to do. That's the water I'm looking for. And it talks about that in Revelations. Turn to Revelations 22. Revelations 22 as we get Ben back up here. Revelations 22. When you get there, say amen. And he showed me the pure river of water of life. Clear as crystal. Proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And of the Lamb. See, the water is the Lamb. In the middle of its street, and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. See, there's leaves. There's leaves off that tree of life, off Jesus Christ. There's leaves that we can take. And we can use for the healing of our nation. For the healing of us. Do you know what kind of world this would be right now if everyone partook and took some of the leaves of Jesus. Just one leaf of Jesus and put it in their heart. just one leaf. If one little mustard seed can move a whole mountain, what could one leaf from Jesus do? Do you understand what we need to do? We need to tell people, take upon the tree, drink upon the water of life. It's here. It'll cleanse you. It'll restore your soul, just like it restored the soul of Samson when he was so down, so desolate, dying of thirst, and it said the water restored him. See, I want to be restored. I want to be restored by the water of God. I want to be restored by Jesus Christ. I want the leaves to heal me of all the transgressions that I have inflicted upon myself. Amen? I love this part. And the leaves from the tree were there for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. His servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. There shall be no night there. They need no lamp, no light, for the Son of the Lord God gives them light. And they shall reign forever. Man, if you don't know Jesus Christ, let me tell you what, there's three things that God can't do. God can't lie. God can't go back on his word. And God can't let you into heaven until you take on Jesus Christ. I'm telling you right now, if you don't know that you know that you know that if you were to die right now, that you'd enter into heaven. If you don't know that, do not leave here. Do not leave here without taking a leaf, branch, something from Jesus. Take him on. Believe that he is the Son of God. He can take all your hurt, all your trouble, everything from you. See, he is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. He's everything. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. All things. Not some things, not a little bit of the things, but all things. Because let me tell you something, without him you can't do anything. You can't do anything. I don't care how hard you try. I don't care how hard you try to clean yourself up. You're never going to get good enough to get to heaven. You've got to take the blood of the Lamb. See, he died on the cross and cleansed us by his blood, and it is up to you. See, the gift's there. It's laying right there. It's in this Bible. All you've got to do is reach up and take it on. I could give you $1 million and throw it right here on the stage, but until you reach down and pick it up, it's not going to do you any good. See, there's only one thing that's going to do good, and that's whenever you pick up Jesus Christ and you put him on. In Jesus' name, if you want to do that, if you want to do that today, and if you've never done that, right now, boldly, raise your hand up and say, I want Jesus in my life right now. I want Jesus in my life. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise his name. Jesus is wonderful. Let's pray. God, I just come to you right now, thanking you for those in this house this morning, those that are watching, that have said, Lord, here am I. I believe that you're the Son of God. Say that with me. I believe you're the Son of God. Lord, I ask you to take all my sin from me, Lord. Cleanse my spirit. Lord, I want to make you my Lord and Master. Lord, I want you to be my everything. I need you, Lord, and I'm saying now, here am I. I'm yours. If you've done that today, if you've done that for the first time, if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, if you know that you can't get to heaven without Him, and you're accepting Him into your life, and you've asked this in the name of Jesus Christ, and if you've made that plea today, if you've made that request for the first time today, if you've decided that you're going to put on Jesus Christ and live for Him, praise God, thank God. You're a new creation in Jesus Christ. If anybody ever asks you, do you know where you're going? You can tell them, yes, I know exactly where I'm going because Jesus lives inside of me. If you want the Holy Spirit, the Bible says that whenever you take on Jesus as your Lord and Master, it says that anyone that asks for the Holy Spirit, it shall be given unto him. Say, Lord, give me the Holy Spirit. I'm a willing vessel. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Let it guide me through life. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts and the promises that you've made to me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God.
No turning back, no turning back, for I have decided to follow Jesus.
Let's all sing. Come on.
To follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. Go none, go with me, still I will follow. Go none, go with me. No turning back, the cross before, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Filled with the Spirit, I'll sing His praises. Filled with the Spirit, I'll sing His praises. Filled with the Spirit, I'll sing His praises. No turning back, no turning back.
Come on, y'all.
Sing glory, glory, and hallelujah. Sing glory, glory, and hallelujah. Glory, glory, and hallelujah. No turning back, no turning back. 'Cause
I have decided
to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided turning back. No turning back.
Woo! Praise God. Praise God, man. Hey, we have a glorious day today, and we're having to do some things a little different because of all these stipulations and stuff, and we want to make everybody feel safe. But we have two people today that want to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And one of them is my brother Kurt there. Stand up, buddy. Y'all give him a hand, man. Praise God. And other is Cammy. Cammy, if y'all want to, let's tell you what we're going to do. We're going to get Cammy to come right down here, and I'll get you, Kurt, to come up here. And if we could get some people, I don't know what y'all do with all the towels and all that, so if I get someone to help me with this, some people that know what's going on. Freddy, hey, there's Freddy, man.
Yeah, Freddy knows how to do it.
Praise God. Man, what a great day. Amen? Yeah. What a great day. Her, just stand right there. Cammy, come right over here. Come right over here. Turn right over here real quick. All right. Man, she come up. I love this little girl. She is so sweet and so precious. She's getting to be a young lady, is she not? And she come up and she said that she wanted to be baptized. And she told her parents that whenever I talked about this, that she wanted to be one of the ones being baptized today. So she's gave her life to Christ. I've talked to her, and she said that she had gave her life to Christ, and she accepted Christ into her heart, and now she wanted everybody to know it. So we're going to ask her right now. Cammy, do you know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? All right. Do you know that He is the only way to heaven? And do you want Him in your heart? And have you accepted Him into your heart? Praise God. Praise God right there. Okay. Come on over here and get in. You probably want to kick off them shoes there. You know what? She's going to be the very first person to ever be baptized in this Rubbermaid tug from TSC. God's good, isn't He? Yes, He is. Tell you what, can I get you to turn around this way? I'm sorry, I know the water's not extremely warm, but we're getting there. We want to make sure and get all that off. You good? We've got a heater coming. It's just not here yet. It's all good. All right. It's okay. Just sit right down. You got it. There you go. Woo, yeah. All right. Scoot this way just a little bit. All right. Okay. Remember your hands? I showed you. Can you do that? Take your hands there. Take this hand here. Put this one over it. And you're going to take and you're going to pinch your nose with that, okay, whenever I tell you to. All right. You believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, right? You accepted Him into your heart, right? You want to be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, correct? All right. Then I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Praise God. In the death we're buried, up in resurrection is a new creation. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Y'all give her a hand. Woo! Here's her shoes. Praise God. Come on up here, Kurt. Walk right around right there and go over and step in there. Into the water here. There's a smart guy. Take his boots off first. Praise God. Praise God. Yeah, just like that. Sit straight down. Straight down on the ground. Take your glasses. Y'all, Kurt come into our church a couple weeks ago, and he come in and said that he had never been to our church, but God had put it on his heart that he needed to change, and he come here and he walked in the door and he He asked to talk to me in the back. And he said that he wanted to give his life to Christ and he wanted to be baptized. And he was ready for something different in life. I'm so excited and so happy that God touched your heart. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? Do you profess Him as your Lord and Savior? By this profession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, praise God. In the death, baptized, and out as a new creation. Y'all give Kurt a big hand. Praise God. Praise God. Let me help you then. You're okay. It's fine. I bet it'll dry. It's probably had more coffee spilled on it than that. Step on out. Praise God. God is good, is He not? Come on, y'all. Let's sing.
Decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Decided,
oh yeah,
to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No.
If you decided today, if you gave your life to Christ and you'd like to talk to me about it, hang on after service and I'd be glad to talk to you. I've got some stuff I'd like to give you and just praise God. Thank y'all for coming today. We're going to start releasing people from the back row first. See, you can teach an old dog new tricks. And if we can, if we get people to go ahead and make your way on out. And praise God.